wrote a poem that's inspired by that.
So let me start.
Again, it's called For Archetypes or the Stubborn Muse. I brought in father to our school. He who lived by book and rule. This isn't a school, is what he said. How will they earn their daily bread? By painting pots? By singing song? This isn't right, most certainly wrong. He saw some more and heaved a sigh. We are so well to do, please then tell why. My granddaughter runs about with holes in her shoes and pants and camisoles. Sand in her hair, mud on her face. Where are the teachers? Who runs this place? Then all at once, a child ran up to dad and said, you look angry, don't be so sad. Just smile, he said, and ran away. Done giving his gift, he went back quickly. Dad looked surprised, he smiled at last, a little wistfully, lost in the past. The lilt of music reached his ears, a familiar raga, it brought out the tears. He wiped his eyes, got back his will. Though it may be nice, I think it still is not an education, just play and fun, just for archetypes, not for everyone. I introduced Dad to a close friend who held him tight for minutes on end. At last, Dad got away from his bear hug. He smiled a wan smile, he gave a shrug. If you're sure it's fine, it's okay, I guess. I can't dictate anymore, only pray and bless. Just tutor her well, teach her arithmetic and English, both writing and phonetic. Some Shakespeare, just the important plays, and maybe some Chinese, it's such a craze these days. Just then a facilitator came up to Dad, embraced him warmly, and said, we're so glad that you could visit us in our space. Look at your child, so much joy and grace. She's really a blessing. You must stay for lunch. Dad protested feebly, but I had a hunch that he wanted to stay and sample the fare, whose fragrant smells wafted through the air. He ate slowly, enjoying the meal, chewing meditatively, taking in the feel of the calming space, the mellow sun that cast rays of gold on everyone. The screech of parrots in the tree above, the caring adults in whose silent love, the children played without a care, no fear, no hate, just purity there. Lunch done, he silently washed his plate with his granddaughter, 75 and 8, together soaping and rinsing a spoon, when he suddenly realized that all too soon, she'd be all grown up and he wouldn't be there to wash spoons with her, to talk, to share. So he paused and took in that entire breath and knew that in her, he was safe from death. For even when he was dead and gone, he lived in her, and so on and on. We drove back home in silence then. Mom opened the door and later went. She asked my dad, so how was school? For archetypes, said the stubborn youth.
Thank you. I'll recite the second poem that I have for today. So this one's called Marjorie Gluten. Again, sort of the inspiration really quickly. Actually, it's really funny that this sort of name or phrase just came to me at night while I was sleeping. So I got up and then I just wrote down the poem. So it's like one of those weird things. But also I would kind of say, you know, maybe I'd sort of been reading about nutrition recently when I wrote the poem, and just sort of thinking about, you know, what happens, you know, all the sort of discrimination we have against, you know, people who are overweight or, you know, kids trying to be really thin. So that's kind of, I think, what was going on when I wrote this poem. This one is a fairly lighthearted one. Enjoy. Marjorie Gluten liked her carbs, through school and college, suffered barbs. About her girth, about her weight, which brought her down, so she ate and ate. She ate more rice, she ate more wheat, and lots of cake and lots of sweet. The more she ate, the more she grew, and behind her back, she was fatty blue. The barbs just kept coming, fast and thick, till one day Marge felt very strange and sick. She moped all day, just lay in bed, and didn't eat a thing, not even bread. She sobbed a bit, then she wiped her tears. When she saw she ate, just for her fears. She cried some more, she wailed, boo-hoo. All these years of eating and I ate for you. From today I'll look inside, see how I feel. Before I eat another morsel or meal. From that day on, Marge ate more slow. She chewed her food and tasted it more. She felt the texture, she smelt the smells. And as she experimented, or so she tells, she realized that eating with sense made every bite taste more intense. With her senses all open now when she ate, she found she didn't care for chocolate. That too much rice always made her sleepy, and that too much sugar made her weepy. So she started to eat only what made her feel good, and she realized with surprise it was healthy food. She started to enjoy her portion small, and soon her weight began to fall. And after years of eating all the while, finally again Marge found time for a smile. She felt so fit, she felt so fine, that she treated herself to a sip of wine. And as Marjorie Gluten lost more weight, for the first time on prom, she had a date. She smiled and laughed and danced the night away. And finally she said, "People, I have something to say. All these years of teasing me about my weight just made me eat more and caused me to hate. Till finally I stopped, and what did I see? That the person I needed love from was me. It was more than enough to make me feel great, and it's finally what made me watch what I ate. It wasn't your kind words, it wasn't any of you. You didn't see Marge, you only saw fatty blue. And if you can't be kind, then you shouldn't dance. All these years I was lonely, you didn't give me a chance. So all you starving uglies, stuff you and your prom, I've found myself, you stay where you're from." With that, Marge stopped. She dumped her date. She went back home, where she sat and ate. Some bread and honey, a little cheese. She felt warm and good, happy as you please. And that's the story of Marjorie Blue. She found herself. Have you found you? Thanks. So who's next?
Next is Nika.
Oh,
and she'll be reciting in English.
He's sulky and grumpy and isn't dining. Mukarit smoking just goes into whining. Mr. Whining is in your mind. Mr. Whining isn't kind. Mr. Whining goes boo-hoo, but Mr. Whining isn't you. So don't stay in bed and keep on whining. Go play and see the sun that's shining.
What's the name of this one? This
Poemairo.
Poemairo?
Yeah. The cat laid it. No, upside down.
Upside down.
The cat laid an egg. The king went to bed. The cow said wow wow. The clock said not now. The queen dressed in rags. The servant took the bags. The market in the sea where the gold was for free. The shopkeeper kissed her hand and gave her a wedding band made with wheel and tea sitting on a silver tree. They got married on a boat and the priest was a goat. They danced and sang till the egg burst with a bang.